In the year 1997, the future is in chaos and turmoil. Mankind is on the brink of extinction. Brave survivors band together and build a time displacement apparatus to receive a signal from a parallel future. This transmission is the Vundacast. Listening to the Vundacast.
Can we do a commercial real quick?
For what?
For a whole lot of.
How do we do a commercial?
Just like this. This is how we do a commercial.
Okay.
That is Andres. I am Steven. You can check out a whole lot of. It's a discussion about Marvel versus DC ongoing.
Cinematically speaking.
It's a discussion of great scary things. Cinematically speaking. It's a discussion of...
We don't even seem that excited about it. Our guess is, talk about...
No, but I'm gonna put some epic music underneath it, so it's gonna sound like it's really exciting.
It's gonna go against...
Yeah, it's gonna go against the aesthetic. It's about
you
the two
like
things
droopy.
Intermixing. No. Didn't Droopy die?
That's the best commercial ever. Should cut right there. Where do you play these commercials?
Usually when my dogs bark and I need to make a commercial break, I will put the commercials on there. And then on, we're on Mondays on radiate.fm.
Mm-hmm. So this commercial would just be, I mean, I never quite understood what this podcast was.
What it is?
Well, yeah. It just always seemed to turn to Marvel versus DC. Mm-hmm. But was that always the...
What was the ethos?
Yeah.
Well, definitely turned more into that once you're around because you created a...
hostility.
A counter narrative.
Yeah.
Towards DC is really good. I just wish they
Look
could.
Look at how he's lying.
I just wish the world could believe it like I do.
Yeah.
No, but
I make Suicide Squad with my own argument. That's my argument. Suicide. I just threw 2 hours. It's like, why do you hate DC? I just play Suicide Squad.
I feel bad.
Oh, she did.
I feel bad because the problem with Suicide Squad, there's like, you know, there's so many moments, and they figured it out because the trailers are better than the movies.
Definitely.
Okay. Because visually, there's a lot of good shit there.
Like what?
Huh? Like, you got, like, giant vats of acid, people hanging over them.
Yeah, and a flashback.
You got, like... Yeah, but I'm saying visually. You got a lot of cool shit.
Yeah, but I always say flashbacks... Like, if there's an action scene and it's done in a flashback, that doesn't count as an action scene. Because, in my opinion...
It takes away all the...
Yeah, it takes away all that.
All
and
that
action,
mental
action,
and the fear of action.
Action is to move forward, and they're literally not. You gotta move forward. It's like Daredevil. I gotta go through that fucking hallway. All act like Die Hard.
I
gotta get to my wife.
But
you know, when you do a flashback, you're completely, you know, and one of these one of the worst movies that did that was Transporter 3, where they had like a huge action sequence done in flashback of him kicking ass, and it's like, and it was done through a phone call. Like he gets a phone call from this guy, and they're like, oh yeah, I know you, and then they flash back to the thing, you know. To the action sequence when they could have just done the action sequence, then he gets a phone call afterwards, you know? It's like, hey, you fucking...
Yeah, you killed one man with a whole
Yeah, you could completely kill...
Is it Run, Little Run?
No.
I don't remember.
No. Because even if it was...
played with all the time. Remember?
Yeah, yeah. But even if it was, she constantly did things different, and that's what made it fun, because it was moving forward.
Mm-hmm. Things were changing.
So yeah, I don't count, like, Suicide Squad to me was very visually boring. Like, they fought in an office space, like one of the action sequences.
Yo, come on! Everyone wants to
go to an ass. They go to
with
an
a machine gun and take out eye monsters what's hilarious is that those, like, the eye, googly eye monsters that everyone turns into,
yeah,
like, that is apparently, like, all of the animators and all the visual designers Warner Brothers hires to design shit, and that googly eye drawing was drawn by the director on, like, a napkin and just handed and been like, yeah,
he
make
just,
something like that.
He coughed in a napkin in his coffee.
And they're like, yeah, 12 googly eyes, yeah, great idea.
That's great. That was so bad. Like, the action sequence went from... What were the set pieces? It was the alley first, and they're just shooting at it. And then there was the office space, and they're just shooting at it.
Well...
And it was, like, done in the exact same...
So you're counting
same.
None of the prison stuff. You're counting...
What was an action thing in the prison stuff?
Well, they had, like, the badass action sequence with Deadpool's introduction. Is it, like, you know...
Deadpool was in it?
I mean, sorry. Deadshot, his introduction... Is like he's
that's
like
not an action sequence.
Ricocheting.
That's not
dude.
A sequence.
Yeah, but there's
that's a
cool,
moment.
There's cool music. There's cool badass music. There's someone shooting a gun. They're moving around. I think that's an action sequence.
No.
Someone dies at the end. That's an action sequence.
He doesn't even move around. He stays in one place and he shoots the bullet to go to that thing.
And then he runs away before he gets caught. That's an action sequence.
No, that was the worst action sequence of the
2016. It was a small action sequence.
And then it was the worst
like, action sequence. Like, it was like a like fan film type of action sequence.
Then She's All That probably had an action sequence. Because I think at one point, the girl punches the guy, right? There's a bunch
the greatest action film of like, the 90s.
They hired like top choreographers.
The girl from She's All That is going to be at SuperCon, Rachel Lee Cook.
Really?
Yeah, it's about time.
Ask her about the Get Carter remake. That's all I care about. Remember that movie?
Tell me about working with Sylvester Stallone.
You were the druggy girl, right?
Who was the director on that?
I remember. It's the guy that did the horror movie Boogeyman afterwards in 2004.
Oh, God.
One of the Sam Raimi movies, Boogeyman. Was awful.
That was not a good one.
No, neither was Get Carter.
He has some bad years.
That was strike two, man. Oh. Strike three. He was in Suicide Squad and they fired him.
So yeah, basically the podcast started out with like just talking about movies, and then my friend Derek wanted to talk about wrestling, and then I just kind of decided that it was like an umbrella to talk about different things with different people. So every time I kind of invest new time in a different person, I create a new sub-brand.
This is a new thing. It's like new guests.
I create like a new sub-brand.
Cool.
So you've been on enough episodes that a whole lot of this is a real thing.
I still think the name should be Now This Is Podcasting.
All right, we can change it to Now This Is Podcasting.
Yeah.
Boom, there you go. A whole lot of just became and Now This Is Podcasting.
Just like that. That's our commercial.
Boom.
You know what? We just changed your name right now in the middle of commercial. Now This Is Podcasting.
Now that's how bold we are. Listen to us, radiate.fm. Because
then you can have Anakin sing, Now This Is Podcasting. Like, you know?
That's
faster than a whole lot of, because then they're just opening up the doors for everyone's a whole lot of bullshit, lot of stupid shit.
I considered our spirit animal for a long time to be, like, the Superman that never was in Justice League with, like, the mullet and, like, the black suit. But now I'm going to retroactively and just imagine him as, like, scarred, destroyed Anakin Skywalker.
Yeah, that's way cooler.
Okay, all, like, gnarly and fucking...
As a little kid.
What?
A little kid all scarred and gnarly.
Oh, we can talk about some of the Star Wars shit. Have you heard about the Star Wars shenanigans going on the internet?
I heard...
Wait, okay, let's start the show.
Okay.
Let's start the movement.
Sure. Now this is podcasting.
All right, we can change it to Now This Is Podcasting.
Yeah.
Boom, there you go. A whole lot of just became and Now This Is Podcasting.
Just like that.
Kurt Russell should be talking. He's like the Meryl Streep of action movies.
Kurt Russell?
Yeah. Big time.
Do that in this.
Disney?
They were like triple X. I want all that in here. Like, they were triple X.
Put them together. Disney has never hired, in a big way, a known Asian director.
That was bad. Hey, I gotta I saw that movie in the theater, and I remember I saw it with a vet, with an old dude with like this, and in the middle of the movie, he takes off his hat. Like, just like,
I don't want to be associated with this.
Not proud of what he was seeing. I swear to God, I asked Diego, we were looking at this vet. I was like, well, I wonder what he thinks of this.
Got the ectoplasmic trash.
Yeah, take it in the face. Take the
ectoplasmic
to the face.
Yeah. Don't take a money shot to the face.
But you know, one of the brilliant things about the original Ghostbusters is like, they're going through all this shit in that workman's like mentality, and then there's that scene where Ray is talking with Winston and like he brings up Bible verses, you know?
Yeah, and it gets all biblical. And it
gets scary. Like they sort of like you see Ray like, holy shit, like what we're doing is really weird. Like that's great.
Yeah, it has a connection.
And I think the problem with Deep Impact, not enough action. Michael Bay knew to like douse the movie throughout little action set pieces.
You know what would be the greatest
versus just one set piece in the last.
What would be the greatest film festival ever?
What?
You do Armageddon, Deep Impact, back to back. Then you do
White House Down. I know exactly where you're going with this.
And Olympus Has Fallen.
Yeah.
Back to back.
Yeah.
What's another
of the two?
Oh, the Magic. You do the Prestige. And the Edward Norton movie.
The Illusionist.
The Illusionist.
Yeah.
Together.
Back
to back. Go full fucking cartoon.
You know who would make
what the fuck?
The perfect Jurassic Park movie? Peter Jackson.
Oh, fuck yeah.
He would make the perfect Jurassic Park movie.
And Jeff Goldblum's in.
If you didn't see that coming, you're a moron.
Huh?
If you didn't see that coming, you're a moron.
Then I guess I'm a moron.
You really thought Jeff Goldblum was going to be in the movie? Now this is the podcast.
There is one greatest podcast and one greatest podcast ever, and it is this podcast. I am your host, Steven, and with me today is the only person with 3 episodes in season 3 of Ash vs. the Evil Dead sitting in the room, undressed.
No, I had one episode.
Is that not how episode math works? I thought that meant you had directed 3 episodes.
No, not even. Probably 1.5 in normal episode math because it's a half-hour show. It's like a sitcom.
Okay, so you like directed like one Cheers.
Yeah. One Full House episode, the Halloween episode.
Well, I guess since
or with Stephanie goes to where no one cares about Stephanie, and she's like, "Look what I can do!" And she starts floating when she learned in space, and she starts floating. That's our episode.
That's good company to be in.
Yeah, it's a classic.
I wonder if you compared your episode to every season 3 episode 3 of any TV show ever. How it would rank, just to see if it's better. Okay?
I wouldn't be able
to
rank
season
it.
3, episode 3 of Star Trek The Next Generation.
Or X-Files.
That is a dud.
I heard, yeah, season 1 I heard was a dud for Star Trek Generations.
Okay. Xena, season 3, episode 3. Boom.
Probably great.
Hercules, season 3, episode 3.
Probably amazing, because these are all Sam Raimi productions.
Yeah, it'd be amazing.
They're amazing.
By season 3, they figured it out, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Except for Hercules, which got canceled after season 3.
Oh, wait, no. Star Trek season 3, I heard. Season 2 is when they got their shit together.
The Next Generation? No. The Next Generation got good in season 3.
Oh, okay.
But they still had some stinkers.
Sure.
And then after season 4, they figured it out.
With the Borg.
Yeah, because the end of season 3 is the big cliffhanger. And then you had to wait a whole summer to figure out if Picard was going to come back to be captain.
All right, so this is a good segue to...
For some reason. We're talking about Star Trek now.
No. Good segue. Who's in a rougher patch right now? Star Wars or Star Trek?
Ooh. That's hard to say. Well, Star Trek just announced... Or just rumored. Because both Star Trek and Star Wars are now clouded in rumors.
Yeah.
Star Trek's rumor is that... Patrick Stewart's gonna return.
So was Spock, wasn't he?
To play Jean-Luc Picard? Spock's dead. No.
In Discovery, though, that's a prequel. Isn't Discovery a prequel to Star Trek?
Discovery is a prequel to the first Star Trek original series.
Which is weird.
But, I don't know.
Because
technology could be on that show, but they haven't put him on that show. I haven't finished
it. They're just throwing things
out. I've only gone up to season 6 on that show, and then it's episode 6 on that show, and then I stopped...
Because it was garbage?
Huh? Well, I stopped watching it because the season 7 episode, they did some retconning to the Star Trek timeline that I thought was hot-ass garbage.
You cannot do that with Star Trek.
And I had to just pause.
Only
JJ. And I'm like, if I'm going to watch this, I'm going to watch this all together. And I've heard some other stuff that makes me want to watch it. But basically, they did this thing where the main character in the show is like Spock's... like stepsister, adopted stepsister. So she's actually human, but she's a human who acts more Vulcan than Vulcans because she grew up on Vulcan after her parents were attacked when she was like 8 years old.
Who were they attacking?
Which is a no, the Klingons, obviously.
Duh.
Which is ridiculous because Worf, when he was 8 years old too, his Klingon parents were killed by Romulans. And then he was raised by Earthlings, adopted as well, in the Next Generation. So it's kind of like they just ripped off that whole Next Generation storyline for her.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, they had Spock's dad on the show. And then for like 6 episodes, they have this thing where Spock's dad, for some reason, only for the plot of storytelling. And even though they have all the technology in the world that you could just talk to someone on a screen, she has a mental connection, force link, force bond with her own dad, so they can Skype in their own brains together. Right? And
yeah.
Then so one of the key points of JJ's Star Trek movie was that Spock decides he doesn't want to go to Vulcan Science Academy. He's going to go fucking fuck off to Starfleet.
Yeah.
In the show, they show in flashback, totally in flashback,
yeah.
While
a
Sarek,
Hugh Jackson scene.
While Sarek is dying, that he... that she wanted to go to Klingon Science Academy. We already know that she didn't. She went to Starfleet. She wanted to go to Vulcan Science Academy. And Vulcan Science Academy said, you have 2 bastard Vulcans. We're only going to let...
Get it together, woman.
We're only going to let one of your shitty Vulcans in. If we let in this girl, we're not going to let in your blood-born son. You decide. Who do you want in? And he said, save it. Let Spock choose if he wants to go in. And so they effed off Michael Burnham. That way. And so that whole like retconning for no reason, I just felt like, yo, you're really trying super hard here.
I mean, why
just tell a new story?
Star Trek is about venturing to the unexplored. Why are they doing all this? Like, it's just like,
I don't know, because they got 26 episodes to fill that you gotta pay for.
Yeah, but like, I want 26 new goddamn planets with new cultures.
I agree.
Like,
I agree.
That's what
Star,
so they're technically fucking up exactly
no,
like Star Wars.
No, but they are kind of. Because basically what this is like, it takes like for what would used to happen in one episode of Star Trek, it takes 4 episodes because they're doing it all serialized and they're like trying to milk every dramatic moment for like someone to click on the next freaking video and stuff.
So it's like obvious.
Yeah, like, it's like slowed down, but the effects are fantastic. It's movie quality effects.
Sure. Well,
they're
that,
spending
there's
hundreds
not, there's
of,
no,
of millions of dollars. On
there's
the
lots of shows that have.
But
really
the Vulcans
good
look horrible.
Yeah.
They're like
how do you
fucking
Vulcan?
I mean, not Vulcan. The Klingons.
Oh,
they
okay.
made them purple, and they're wearing like fucking like Tybalt like Shakespeare outfits and shit. They have like those like collars and like but with spikes. It's like really really.
So you would probably say
garbage.
That Star Trek is worse, is doing worse than Star Wars right now.
Yeah, because Star Wars is fucking killing it. They're amazing. I love Star Wars right now. I love Solo. Love Last Jedi. The one film that everyone seems to like so much that I think does not stand up is Rogue One, which I'm ironically wearing the hat for right now.
Yeah, Rogue One.
I don't think Rogue One holds up.
I don't think it was ever good.
I don't think it
Last Jedi is... really bad,
I don't
too.
Think it holds up. But I think Solo is, like, the most rewatchable Star Wars movie.
Probably.
And Last Jedi 2 is the most rewatchable Star Wars movie.
Really?
Yeah. Because, like...
after seeing Last Jedi, I was like, man,
so
I'm way
fun.
Too hard on Force Awakens. Way too hard.
I should have saved some of this vitriol for this
yeah,
one.
Yeah, like, oh, this is...
this is where the venom
maybe
was all along.
I saw Force Awakens, and I was like, I know where this is going. And so I put all my hate on that.
So on Twitter, there was a movement... started by a Twitter account calling
where all the best movements are started.
Remake Star Wars The Last Jedi.
Yeah,
and then he made people he set up a page where people could
write
say
down.
What they would pledge up to $10,000 and for up to $10,000 he would bring you to the premiere of his remake of Star Wars The Last Jedi as a producer, as you should be. But he didn't actually collect money.
He's going to direct it?
He just asked... No, this person is totally anonymous. They say that they have a collective of filmmakers that are ready to take on the intense burdens of this.
I want
to
know who these filmmakers
and
are.
And they just need the public to pressure Disney to hand over the rights to Star Wars. Like Danny, she thinks that it's a joke. But, I don't know, it feels... There's too much... They're engaging in it so much that I feel like it's not a joke. you know?
You never know these days. You never know. You never know.
Yes, I guess. But everyone was
ripping
on them.
Like that subreddit.
Rian Johnson tweeted them back and was just like, ha 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 ha, and just like laughed at them and shit. It was fucking amazing.
Yeah. He's been on a Twitter tear, apparently, blocking a lot of people. And
why shouldn't you?
Well,
you have to.
I'm just commenting.
The Star Wars fans drove freaking Rose off of Twitter. They put Jake Lloyd in possibly the grave. I'm not sure if he's dead or not.
Which rumor do I believe? I think he's in jail.
Okay, he's in jail.
There was something he was arrested
for. Hayden Christensen was going to have a promising career.
No.
Okay. I saw My Life as a House, okay? And he was fantastic.
Exquisite.
He was fantastic.
Listen.
Okay?
No matter what, if you had talent, you were going to make, like, Ewan McGregor, you know, he got away from that Star Wars crap because he was good.
No. He got away from the Star Wars because he wanted to not just do Star Wars forever. But he still did sci-fi. Like, he kind of... Let me see. He followed.
Yeah,
up.
After
he did The Island first,
he
right?
Did literally the same year.
The Island was the same year.
2005.
As Phantom Menace? Oh no.
No, as Revenge of the Sith. He
okay.
Michael Bay'd it. So he had the.
And then did he take a break from sci-fi for a little bit? Ewan McGregor hasn't done like.
I've seen him around.
He's done a lot of stuff.
Yeah,
he's done a lot of stuff, but he just doesn't do like every genre. You know what I mean?
Yeah, or he doesn't. I don't see him in blockbusters anymore. Like I see him like in the
dude. He's about to do a blockbuster called Christopher Robin for Disney.
Yeah, yeah, whatever.
Which I think is their Disney soft test of seeing if is he a big enough star that if we make the Obi-Wan movie, we'll get $1 billion.
I mean, they shouldn't even bother with any of it. They should just move on.
No, they need to lock him down as, like, a Disney legend, like Johnny Depp and all these people, and put them on a retainer for millions of dollars because they want to have Ewan McGregor at the theme park whenever the fuck they want him. All over the world, whenever the fuck they want him. He's going to get signed up big time. 100% guaranteed.
For what? Just to walk around the park?
Huh? To show up at their events and, you know, help them promote the theme parks and...
What?
Promote all the Star Wars lands? Yeah. What do you think Johnny Depp goes and plays pirate in front of when they open up a new Pirates of the Caribbean ride and shit? Disney likes that shit.
Because he's got nothing else.
Oh, he's got his wine.
Yeah, he's got wine.
Oh, he's got his wine in debt.
It's either that or he's touring, right? He's touring in Europe.
He's a huge...
Johnny Depp.
Music
oh, shit.
Johnny Depp. I didn't see Trainspotting 2. Oh, my God.
No.
Someone's got to watch that. Poor Trainspotting. Oh, he's in that Jane Got a Gun movie? I didn't see that either.
Yeah, he's doing a bunch of, like, stuff that,
Mordecai?
Well, he needs to do a fucking horror film to get it over with.
He was in A Million Ways to Die in the West? God damn. That was the Seth MacFarlane movie?
Yeah,
that
I know.
Also
I know that
flopped
one.
So hard. He was in Jack the Giant Slayer. He did Bryan Singer's movie. Come on.
He doesn't know how to pick his blockbusters, man.
Apparently.
Shit.
You heard about the Bryan Singer, Queen movie?
I don't care about biographies and stuff.
About biopic movies?
Biopics, I don't care about
Well,
those.
What's interesting is he got kicked off the movie. He didn't finish filming it.
Uh-huh.
And he's still getting the director's credit.
Who is?
Bryan Singer.
Oh, really?
Yeah, his DP finished the filming of the movie the last, like, month of filming.
Oh, that's gonna be a mess, huh?
And Bryan Singer, yeah. Well, in the trailers, they don't even, like, really show that Freddie Mercury's gay. So I think that movie's just gonna be a giant train wreck. Like, if that's not your selling, if that's not your
Does
angle
it say from the directors of X-Men Days of Future Past?
No. They don't want to put his name on a screen because
Why?
His name is associated with boy fondling.
Is it, though?
Yeah, he was
I mean, I
tied
heard,
up in a bunch of...
I heard accusations, but he hasn't been charged.
Party boy sex scandal.
He hasn't been charged.
I think he was charged.
I don't think he was charged.
And he had...
I think they thought he was going to get charged and they dropped him before.
No, he got dropped because he was an asshole on set.
Oh.
Yeah.
You know who I hear is also in those pool parties, allegedly? Roland Emmerich.
Whoa. That makes sense. I buy it. I buy it. I see him hovering over like a 16-year-old, 17-year-old
like
boy.
Like the spaceship in
Independence
Day?
Like the spaceship in Independence Day, just waiting to
just
open up his blast beam. That's sad.
It is sad.
It kind of shows how he ruined Godzilla. I mean, it's kind of... makes sense.
I mean, I used to. I mean, you know, I was a teenager. I used to like his movies, but like
as I grow older, I still like Independence Day. Independence Day is...
Yeah, that's probably his best one.
That's
his best one.
That was his moment.
People would say Star. He has a lot of really good ideas in his movies, and they just doesn't.
He doesn't work them right. Yeah,
he doesn't work them right at all. Stargate's a great idea.
Stargate's a great idea, and the TV show too is just a waste too. Like they never figured out how to make it cool.
I heard Stargate the TV show was really good.
That's what people claim to me, but I've yet to see.
Yeah, I don't like seeing people just go in and like, oh, we're in another world, we're in the fucking jungle.
See, my thing
is
Stargate, you got fucking Kurt Russell in that movie.
Yeah.
You should be doing more with Kurt Russell in this movie.
Well,
it's like Soldier. You hire Kurt Russell to be a fucking badass actor, and then you give him nothing to say.
Yeah.
And nothing to do.
I like that.
And nothing to do. He's just like looking around.
He had
like,
that badass chain
face.
Fight. He had a chain fight.
He had cool fights, but I'm just saying the whole movie, he's silent and just like looking grumpy.
I like that. I like that in Soldier. In fact, he should have given him less lines.
No! Blasphemy.
Yeah, they should have given him less lines.
He's the best talker in the
movie. Where he's just like, yeah, that's true. But that shows his range, like where he's just a silent soldier. And like, and he's really awkward around this community of hippies.
You give Dolph Lundgren that role. He's in a not silent soldier out of the park.
Mm-hmm.
Kurt Russell should be talking. He's like the Meryl Streep of action movies.
Kurt Russell?
Yeah. Big time. He's like the best actor of any action movie star.
Him and Bruce Campbell, they might do something together.
Oh my god.
Because those guys could probably out-talk each other.
That would be amazing.
That would be really good.
Like Ash and fucking Jack Burton teaming up.
He's always going to be Snake Plissken for me, but that's fine.
I'll take your Snake. That's fine. I'll take in the guy missing an eye with the guy.
But
missing
that was also that shows his range. Like Kurt Russell, like Snake Plissken, is completely different from Jack Burton, right?
Yeah, 100%. Well, you know, Snake Plissken is based off of Clint Eastwood.
Sure.
He's doing a Clint Eastwood impersonation, and then Jack Burton is supposedly based off of John Wayne.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like the two cowboys.
Now we're like this whole 80s nostalgia thing came back. But there wasn't, like, I felt like it was, everything was a little bit too tongue-in-cheek, right? In like, the 80s nostalgia comebacks, like, everything, you know, about the 80s, loving the 80s.
Everyone's culture in general?
Yeah, like, movies, like, everyone was redoing the Goonies, basically, you know, from Stranger Things.
Mm.
Attack the Block had that a little bit, had the genius to modernize it,
mm-hmm.
well, versus just, or Turbo Kid.
Well, Attack the Block... As much as it gets put next to those type of movies, Attack the Block stands out a lot more than Stranger Things.
Yes, because it modernizes
like it makes it really, like, it's unique.
It made it more modern. But my point is like, no one tried really, I guess The Guest, maybe, but no one tried doing The Carpenter, like, you know, with, like, dead serious. Like, that was the thing about Carpenter, is like, it may seem corny, but like, The tone of all those movies were so dead serious.
Well, the thing about Carpenter is he wasn't afraid to, like, turn the whole movie's universe into the tone that he was trying to give you.
Yeah.
You know? He wasn't afraid. Like, the thing about, like, the Goonies and stuff like that is that it feels like you're in one movie and also in another movie. You're not just, like, you're in two movies that are mixing up. You're in a kid's adventure movie and a crime movie mixed together.
Sure.
The Goonies has the more mashup.
That's like a Spielberg thing, right?
Mashup, yeah, mentality. And then even to the point that you have, you know, a guy in a monster in a Superman shirt pretending to swashbuckle. It's much more of like, I think, a mashup aesthetic when John Carpenter makes his movie all one aesthetic to the point that the whole universe becomes like that one aesthetic.
That's a good point. He did that, Spielberg with Gremlins, doing the Christmas movie with the monster movie. Like, and he did it both very... He mixed it very well.
I don't know
why
they didn't go, like, Gremlins 3. Like, it hurts to think that you couldn't get a trilogy.
I
out of the Grimms. The Gremlins.
I can't imagine how hard it must be to do a Gremlins movie. Because they gotta be...
So many puppets.
Like, what, I mean, and it's like, when you go after Gremlins 2, when they're just literally, like, just, like, anything you want, like, that mentality,
mm-hmm.
like, how do you follow up with that? I mean, I guess you go back to what they're probably going to do, or what they even thought about at one point, was let's make them scary again. It's like, let's do fucked up gremlins, like, you know? They're trying to make them all dark and shit.
I was going to do gremlins again. Because, obviously, time has passed now.
Yeah.
Right? But Gizmo's magic. He doesn't have to age.
Well, I could get... You know who they were talking to for gremlins, right?
Who?
Jordan Peele.
Whoa.
At one point. Just a little talk. Just Chris Columbus apparently called him up. Had a little talk about him.
So they too feel the hurt that Gremlins 2.
Yeah.
There's no Gremlins 3. But they won't make a Gremlins 3. It'll just be a reboot.
Yeah, it would
if
be
they
a reboot.
Did it.
Yeah, so no,
I
don't know.
I want the 3.
You know who needs to do Gremlins?
That's why people got mad at the Ghostbusters remake. Because the movie that people want is Ghostbusters 3.
Yeah.
The movie public, especially people that were brought up in 80s movies, there is the need that you want a trilogy.
There was also, you know, which I'm not the first to say, but the idea of Ghostbusters, like, what made Ghostbusters great is that all sort of the jokes
mm-hmm.
or whatever sort of revolved around the paranormal
mm-hmm.
versus, like, the new one, that the jokes were just anything, you know? Like, there wasn't any focus on being a Ghostbuster, really?
Yeah, I can see that.
You know? There was just, like, they would joke about the Chinese food and this
well,
and that. And
well, I think the thing that I notice about the Ghostbusters remake, which I do enjoy, I think it's a fun movie, it's just a different aesthetic than the original Ghostbusters movie. They use the comedy, like, to make you... They want to use the comedy to make you like the characters.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They don't just want to let the characters, like, sort of, like... just stand and be characters
just
before
be characters.
They're comedic.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because that's what's kind of cool about the first Ghostbusters movie is that it kind of, like, lures you into that all of these people are funny.
In their own way.
Like, even Winston. Like, you don't think Winston's funny, and then at the end of the movie, he has some of the best jokes. Like, the movie kind of, like, it gives over everyone's comedy as sort of like, oh, now you know this character enough, this is how they're funny.
I mean,
that's what
except
I love. Except
for
Venkman.
No.
But that's because that's
Winston,
is.
Like, the best, in my opinion, one of the best jokes, mm-hmm. like, that idea that the minute he gets hired, they take him down, and they're explaining this paranormal shit, and then, like, he's trying to fit in, so he's like, tell him about the Twinkie. Like,
yeah.
You know, it's like, that's great.
That's
and then, like, Egon is, like, the weirdo nerd, you know, I guess... sort of scientist.
Well, yeah,
and then
I collect molds and spores and
funguses. And then what's like, Ray? Ray's just like a plucky, like excited about everything.
Ray's the heart.
Yeah.
Ray's the heart of the Ghostbusters. He's the one who's like always like has the emotional reaction to things. Like he's gonna fuck a ghost to the mouth.
Yeah.
Like he's gonna fucking, you know, he's like wants to go down the pole over and over.
Yeah,
he's the emotional reaction of the team in a way.
Yeah. And then what about the new cast? What are their characters?
Well, Holtzman, who's my favorite character.
Which one's that one?
Which is the Kate McKinnon character, the
Oof.
Blonde, right?
Man,
she's the Egon, but I think she's the Venkman Egon. Like she's an Venkman Egon
See,
hybrid.
That's where they fucked up.
Because she's the one who knows all the tech.
They gave her two characters. Stick to one.
She's the one who knows all the intense tech stuff. But she's the one who's, like, confident enough in herself that she'll say whatever the fuck she wants. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because all the other characters kind of, especially Kristen Wiig's character, I don't think there's a clear allegory for Kristen Wiig's character in the new...
Yeah, what is
she
her...
She doesn't...
I guess she's a straight man in a weird way?
She's kind of... I would kind of say if you have to put her next to anyone in the original movie, she's kind of the Peck, I guess.
Peck?
Isn't that the guy's name? The guy who has no dick?
Oh,
the government guy?
Yeah.
He's like...
Well, that's what I heard.
You know, he's just... She doesn't want to believe. She's a skeptic. And then even when she's on the team, she still is, like, you know, doubting and anxious. And, you know, the whole arc of the movie is her getting the confidence to believe in the team and, you know, achieve their mission.
Yeah,
blah,
you
blah.
See, this is not... Like, the... It's Ghost, like, Ghostbusters didn't have that. Like, it didn't have that. It was so focused on its jokes and so focused on making the characters within...
What do the characters in the original Ghostbusters movie, what is their arc? What do they learn?
Do they have character arcs? Okay,
Venkman likes a girl, he hooks up with a girl. He gets everything he wants, basically.
Yeah. I think, in general, probably their business kind of has the arc, right? Where they get...
So it's about trying to be successful, and then you get the ultimate success, which is people cheering on you.
Yes.
And everyone believing you and chanting your names in the streets.
Yes.
And you have a big, fat government contract, hypothetically.
Yes. But that is interesting that none of them have an arc, technically. I can't think of one, at least for
Elon. I guess in a way, it would be like, if their arc is as simple as, you know, in the beginning, they were shitting their pants running away from these ghosts, and now they've gotten to the point that seeing all the fucked up shit these ghosts do has become mundane and everyday and routine work.
Yeah, where they become like exterminating, like,
you know,
exterminators.
Maybe that's the arc that they became.
Maybe.
They used to be intellectual, college liberal elites, and now they became working class schlubs who aren't afraid to, you know,
yeah,
take out the ectoplasmic trash.
Yeah, take it in the face. Take the ectoplasm to the face. Yeah,
don't take a money shot to the face.
But you know, one of the brilliant things about the original Ghostbusters is like they're going through all this shit in that workman's like mentality,
mm-hmm.
and then there's that scene where Ray is talking with Winston, and like he brings up Bible verses. You know?
Yeah, and it gets all biblical.
And it gets scary. Like, they sort of, like, you see Ray, like, holy shit, like, what we're doing is really real. Like, that's great.
Yeah, it has a connection to the world. Especially, my favorite scene is that prison scene. When they just start talking about stuff, and then you just see all the prisoners
just, like,
slowly gathering in and trying to listen. And
trying to figure it out.
Like, what the fuck? Like, I kind of wish that had, like, a payoff in the movie.
Yeah.
Where, like, the prisoners get, like, broken out of jail by a ghost or something like that, and you get that sort of comedic interplay and stuff.
I think that's what made that scene, like, that scene, every scene had such creativity and, like, a new angle, you know, that they could leave some behind. I think that's fine. Like, that's a great angle of, like, the prisoners are trying to get this shit, like, listen to these nerds. And it's like...
The other thing that I think that movie has that makes it unique and, like, really lasts over time, and Ghostbusters 1 and Ghostbusters 2, is, like, movies from, like, basically any 80s New York movie, just has, like, you know, New York is such a rich character in that movie.
Yeah.
And it just, there's a different, like, there's just this, like, million-dollar feeling about being in New York at that time. That any way you look is like, whoa, this movie's expensive.
Yeah. I think the one thing that I only like about the sequel, because I don't think the sequel's very good, was that it definitely focused a lot more on the horror. Like, where there were some actual, genuine, creepy-ass scenes in there.
Oh, yeah.
Versus
like, the
first
that
one.
Baby gets taken.
And you know, I learned that before Evan Reitman did all the... did all these comedies, he was actually a producer for David Cronenberg's early work, like Shivers, and I believe, what was the other one? He did one, Rabid. I think he produced Rabid, too. So he was, like, into that horror thing, and I think
he
really unleashed it.
In.
Yeah, he kind of unleashed it in that second Ghostbusters movie, or at least what he learned. And I thought that was really, really good. But in Ghostbusters 2, I didn't think... It had one funny joke, I guess, which was the suck in the gut guys.
What are your thoughts on the first Ghostbusters reboot, a.k.a. Evolution?
Which one?
Evolution. Ivan Reitman. David Duchovny.
Oh, yo, that was hot garbage, man.
But that was like the first...
That
like,
was hot
that,
garbage. Because
they sold that movie like, oh, this is what Ghostbusters would be
100%.
Like, if like we did it in 2000, oh my god.
That was... I remember that summer. That
we got Orlando
out.
Jones.
That
we
was
David Duchovny.
That is probably the worst summer in the history of movies.
Ooh.
2001 was the worst summer, I'm going to claim right now.
That was the summer of Austin Powers, International Man of Mystery. How could you say?
No, it wasn't. That was 97, and then the sequel came out in 99. 2001 was the summer of Pearl Harbor.
Oh, God.
Jurassic Park 3, Tomb Raider.
Oh, shit.
Evolution. Like,
oh,
this
shit.
Was the worst summer. The best summer movie was Moulin Rouge.
No, the best summer movie was X-Men 2000, which doesn't hold up well.
X-Men, no, that was 2000.
Oh, shit.
The X2 came out in 2003, which was a great year for summer movies. 2001 was a dog.
Now the question
and
is...
And then American Sweetheart summer
did
movie.
Did they make money?
Probably.
Did 2001 still make money?
Probably. Not as much as it could have. Jurassic Park 3. Pearl Harbor. Remember that? Everyone saw that Pearl Harbor trailer and everyone was just like, I remember in my class, everyone was like, this movie's going to be the greatest movie ever made. And I was a huge Michael Bay hater back then, so I was like, Michael Bay, you guys have no idea where what's coming.
Well, that's because everyone thought like, oh man, this is going to be like Titanic, but it's going to have action.
With Saving Private Ryan.
But with action in the middle.
And then
oh
you're like,
God.
PG-13, idiot. you ain't going to see shit. You ain't going to see shit.
Hey, man, I'll watch Radio shoot a machine gun any day of the week.
Yeah, we weren't shooting Radio. Radio was shooting us.
He saved our lives.
That was a bad... Hey, I saw that movie in the theater, and I remember I saw it with a vet, like an old dude with like his... and in the middle of the movie, he takes off his hat. Like, just like...
I don't want to be associated with this.
Not proud of what he was seeing. I swear to God, ask Diego. We were looking at this vet. I was like, well, I wonder what he thinks of this. And the next time you look at him, his hat's off. Like, he's like, fuck this. It was during not even the bombing happened yet. He's like, wait, are you... Roger Ebert has the best review. Best review to sum up the movie. Pearl Harbor is about how the Japanese bombed a love story. bombed a love triangle.
It's such a just Josh Hartnett and Ben Affleck have like no on-screen chemistry
you
together
can't,
at all.
Ben Affleck worked in Armageddon because he had Bruce Willis. He was the guy. He was the second guy. He can't be the first guy. Ben Affleck's a great second dude. He's like, he can't be the star. You know,
wow.
And obviously I've been proven wrong with Argo,
whoa,
which I didn't personally
theory.
Like. I personally, yeah, Good Will Hunting.
I never saw Argo.
Yeah.
I
honestly turned it off. I was really bored with it. But I understand he's a great director. The opening scene was really good and intense. The town was great.
I understand he's a great
director. Yeah, I could, there's...
I'll accept that he's a good director.
There's movies out there that I just don't like, but I understand why people like them. Like the Planet of the Apes movies, these new ones that everyone says are great, I cannot stand them. I totally respect people that like them. They're just not for me. So I just don't... I can't get it. After the second one, I saw the second one, I was like, I don't know what the fuck is going on here.
I don't care.
The whole movie
yeah.
should have been
yeah.
Apes talking in sign language. That would have been great. That would have been different. But then they...
Well, like the first two Daniel Craig James Bonds.
Yeah.
Casino Royale's awesome.
Yeah.
And Quantum of Solace is hot, stinking garbage.
It's better than Spectre.
And doesn't make any sense.
It's better than Spectre.
Well, the yeah, it is better than Spectre.
Yeah.
But the thing is, like, what I don't even understand is the plot of Quantum of Solace, I didn't understand it till like, a year ago.
Yeah.
Like, at all.
I still don't understand it.
Like,
bad guy. The bad guy gets
so
people land?
It's,
guess,
first,
it's so simple, right?
Well, it's the first...
it's almost confusing.
It's the first direct sequel to a James Bond movie ever. James
yeah.
Bond has never had any direct sequels ever. Okay?
They have little hints
which is,
of it.
No, it's a direct sequel. Which basically means that you should watch them as one movie if you want to understand.
Wait, that was the thing. I think Quantum of Solace gets known as, like, that's more of an epilogue to Casino Royale than its own movie.
Yeah, and basically all that Quantum of Solace says is that she was married to a dude that she didn't know, but he was in a secret organization called Quantum. And that dude only ever hooked up with her and hooked up with chicks so that once he made them fall in love with him, he would disappear, and then they would blackmail these people and use them in their positions of power to do whatever they wanted as a criminal organization.
Wait, to
which
the women? So he would blackmail the women?
So, yeah, this guy would disappear, and then this organization...
Would blackmail the women.
Would blackmail the women that he was hooking up with, that they wanted him to, and she worked at the Treasury, so they needed her to... move money for Le Chiffre in the first movie.
That's a lot of pressure on
and
that
then
guy to hook up
basically,
with basically,
James Bond learns, figures out the mystery, and then is just out for revenge. Which is just horrible. Like,
yeah.
This is, like, even when you explain the plot, I understand why you obfuscated the plot now.
Yeah.
To make it less intelligible. So it would be more rewatchable. But, yeah, that's a whiffer of a... of a sequel to a really good first movie.
Yeah, but they cleaned it up in
So is Last Jedi better than Quantum of Solace? That was
no.
was all I was leading towards.
No.
What?
No. And I'm gonna give you a Star Wars hot since you come back
blasphemy.
To
blasphemy.
Star Wars hot take. I'm gonna give you a hot take. You're gonna hear it first here. Star Wars needs to stop making movies and start making video games. That's it. The movies are done. Let's have these people everyone go to these worlds now.
Yeah, you think they're going to switch from just Lucasfilm to LucasArts? You're crazy.
I am, but I'm saying what they should do.
What they should do.
I think they should stick to video. Video games are good enough now to tell compelling stories if they want to. They're more immersive.
I would argue that maybe you're right, and maybe the problem is doing one movie a year is too much. You know, maybe. I don't think so, but maybe.
Yeah.
And just do 1 year, you release a movie, and then the next year you release like 2-3 video games, like big releases.
Yeah.
And you just kind of have that stream. So that the thing that's holding you over to the next Star Wars movie is, you know, the fountain of Star Wars video games and Star Wars
books. I think they should just have...
And comic books and all the other...
If you have
stuff.
A Star Wars video game, I think then you could go to the Tatooines again. You could do all that with players.
All the revisiting.
Yeah, all the revisiting you'd want to do. Because you're going to... You, it's yourself, you're going to visit it, you know, as the character you're playing as. And I think... And also, you could also... You know, they do it, quote-unquote, open world. You get to who you talk to, who you do, like, all that, I think, matters a little more. Versus, you know, in a movie, you see, like, oh, we saw this character before.
Were you ever an MMORPG guy?
I was.
Yeah?
I still am.
What did you play, Warcraft?
I did play a little bit of Warcraft. I played a little bit of the old, you know, that's
the
why
Star
I said...
Star Wars Online game?
Yeah, the Star Wars Online game I played.
Yeah, you played the shit out of it?
Yeah. I didn't play the shit out of
you
it.
You played some
play
of it.
But the one game...
Because I bought that game. And I was ready to play it, and then I could never have a computer that was strong enough.
Let me tell
to
you
play
something.
It.
The greatest Star Wars story ever told, from what I've like, I haven't read any of the books or anything. I've read the one book that was like tales, like short stories. That was pretty good.
Tales of Mos Eisley Cantina, Tales of Jabba's Palace.
Yeah.
Tales of the Bounty Hunters. Those are my three favorite.
Yeah, I read that. But there was this video game called Knights of the Old Republic.
Yeah, for Xbox, I played the crap out of that game.
That
game was
That had the best Star Wars story, and it did it so much better than what George Lucas did with the prequels. Like, the way it defined the dark side, you know, and the, you know, the
and
light.
The light side, and,
like,
you know,
the way
all the
they
decision
did
making.
Perfect.
And then,
beautiful.
And then,
poetic.
And then going through the walkthrough and getting to get HK-47.
Yeah, which
and
Rogue
he's
One
just,
stole
like,
from.
Comedic, you know.
It was
genius.
Just perfect.
No, but HK-47's a lot funnier than K2SO, I would say.
Which one's which?
HK-47 is the one from Knights of the Old Republic that he's just constantly calling
you meatbags, yeah.
And he's just obsessed with wanting to kill people.
Yeah.
Like the droid with a kill lust. I don't think we're ever going to get it from from Disney. But when we got it from LucasArts, that was that good stuff.
That was
BioWare, no?
That was BioWare.
Yeah.
They did that my favorite franchise.
But the sequel, doesn't hold up.
I never played it.
I played it. Spoilers. The Jedis are kind of not so good at the end.
No, oh.
That's the spoilers. The Jedis may be
well. That was beautiful.
Wrong.
That's what I liked about the first one. First one had that great twist.
Yeah,
the
guy in the mask is you.
It's you.
Fucking crazy.
That's great. I didn't see it
that's
coming.
Crazy. And then it's kind of like, oh man, ever since you had amnesia, have you decided to become the same person, or have you learned from your mistakes? And it makes the storytelling like even
that's
deeper.
That's true sci-fi.
You know, and then even when
that is true sci-fi.
And then what's cool is that once you find out. You kind of have, like, I don't think you're all the way through the game, so you kind of can, like, decide if you want then at that point, like, hey, I'm gonna go good now, fuck this, I'm not gonna be evil.
And the worlds
you know
and the rules,
like,
yeah, every world had its own, like, code, like, it was just, I thought it was just,
it
was genius, and that's sort of what gave me, it's like, you know what, maybe Star Wars just belongs in video games. Let's visit these worlds now, especially if you're gonna go with nostalgia.
And then it made it so much sense, too, especially when you, like, we're going out and picking your lightsaber crystal and changing your lightsaber's color and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, just, it taught you about Star Wars in a way that...
The movies never can.
That felt natural.
And the movies never can.
That in a movie would feel like, yo, this guy's doing too much exposition right now.
Yeah, it's too boring, because that's what makes, also, the video game's great. You could choose to not engage in that. You can press A and get the dialogue, and this mission
kind
of fun
hacking and slashing and doing anything.
Yeah, I think Star Wars...
I agree.
Belongs
that's our hot take out of this podcast.
Yeah.
Go download Knights of the Old Republic. It's available on iPhone
and
on
Steam.
Xbox and Steam and all over the place.
Great game. Probably the best Star Wars story.
The only other RPG that I played as much, but only because I was stuck on it, was Final Fantasy VII.
Oof.
Which, I was stuck on Final Fantasy VII for like, I guess till now, because I never beat it. I never beat it. I could never get that crazy sword. I could never take out Sephiroth. Never get the Ultima sword.
I never got into JRPGs. I try so hard, but I just can't get into them.
Yeah, they're very long.
They're very long.
They're intensive. Yeah.
A lot of the same shit.
I didn't get it. I don't know how people play every Final Fantasy game.
Well, the new one's a little different.
But,
it's open world.
But every Final Fantasy game is basically a remake of the last Final Fantasy game. But now the chocobos are a little different this time, and now you're, you know, whatever. Like, it's just basically like a reimagining every time.
Yeah.
Like, every game is remake. Except for, like, Final Fantasy X-2 or something.
Well, this new one seems pretty different. You're with your bros.
Yeah,
it's a bro game. It's a bro game. It's about a prince that is about to get married, I'm not quite sure.
So
all his bros go on a road trip, and they go on a road trip.
And they're all white bros?
They're all, huh?
They're white bros?
Of course, they're white bros. Final Fantasy.
Yeah, okay. So.
Ain't no black people in Final Fantasy.
Yeah, there was.
I know, I'm just kidding.
There was fucking Barrett?
Is that his name?
Is it?
There was a guy with the afro, but that was a bad one.
The Gatling gun guy.
Oh, that's right. In 7, yeah. No, there was one in 14-2 and all that. The guy had an afro and 2 guns.
Yeah.
I was thinking of Lord of the Rings, sorry.
I was saying, Final Fantasy is going, you know, against Star Wars time. Because Star Wars, you know, cast minorities, cast women in the leads.
Yeah. To the...
Final Fantasy is just appealing to their bro audience.
Can we talk about that?
Disney will resist.
Can we talk about that?
Sure.
Because I was thinking a lot about that.
We can talk about anything, because this show is called Now This Is Podcasting.
Now This Is Podcasting. About lectures, about the whole anti-social justice...
Warrior phenomena.
Where it seems like... It's pretty interesting that these people... They think it's a political move?
Yeah, they think that they're getting ahead politically.
They think that putting a woman to star in Star Wars is a political move.
Well, I think that...
Right? That seems to be the gist of it.
Well, I think that they're kind of
and
like...
And why do they have a problem with that?
It just seems like they don't like when people humanize people that aren't, like, the leads we're used to. That aren't, like, Bradley Cooper-looking people.
Yeah.
Like, that's what people are resistant to.
This guy made a great point where he was like, you know, it's like... And whenever these movies fail, for like Ghostbusters, you know, like whenever these movies fail, it's just like, aha.
That's the one.
It's the women's fault, you know, but it's like, this guy made a point. It's like, when you watch Green Lantern, you're never going to be like, it's because it was a guy. It's because it was Ryan Reynolds that Green Lantern failed. But they're quick to point out that if it's a, like Ocean's 8.
These women can't handle it. They can't handle it, whatever the fuck. Which, Ocean's 8 was actually pretty damn good.
It got decent reviews, apparently. Apparently, the actresses were angry at critics for some reason, but it seems like it got pretty decent reviews.
I didn't hear that, but the movie just plays as, like, something, you know, it's popcorn.
It's bullshit.
It's easy to watch, you know, it could be an episode of the Ocean's show, whatever. Yeah. It's just easy to watch, and it's fun.
That famous voice actor that did Samurai Jack.
Phil Lamar? Yeah.
Phil Lamar said something great. He goes, equality, when everything's in the same playing field, isn't when Black Panther comes out. It's when Black Panther comes out along with Homeboys from Outer Space.
Yeah.
So it's like when a minority's allowed to fuck up and get the other chance, then that is equal. Just like how like the people on top, they're allowed to fuck up all they want.
Yeah, because you said at the beginning, like, fucking this guy who whiffed it on what the fuck are we talking about? This guy, he got two strikes. What the fuck are we talking about at the beginning? This shitty director.
The guy,
Get Carter. Alright?
I think his name is Stephen K or something K.
Okay. That guy got to fail
yeah
real hard several times in a row.
And they're big fails because I think Boogeyman made money, but it's still, like, so bad that it was like...
Yeah, like, how could you...
Like, we can look him up right now.
Sure. But that guy...
Let's see what he did after. He probably did TV. That's what they go to.
Just off being a dude in the industry, he got a lot more, you know, he got a lot more strikes than most minorities would get.
Sure. Hey, can you imagine if Black Panther failed? Can you imagine if Black Panther failed?
Yeah. Ryan Coogler would be, like...
They would never trust...
With $200 million ever again.
Yeah, they would never trust any African-American
Tim
movie.
Story, he fucked up Fantastic Four 2, even though he made money on Fantastic Four 1, and he got relegated to barbershop movies.
The director of Get Carter is Stephen King. Man, do I know my shit or what?
Right. Do I know my shit about the world?
Do I know my shit about bad remakes? All right. Yeah. And I called it, he does TV.
Whoa.
Taken?
Oh, no. Why?
The Lizzie Borden Chronicles?
He loves remakes. I love it. Oh, Lizzie Borden Chronicles, I heard was good.
The Shield. Okay, so he does good TV. He does good TV.
A few episodes.
He does good TV. Good for him. He got it together.
Hey, everyone.
It's that Hollywood shit.
Well, everyone has their strengths, you know.
Yeah.
Maybe he's a fantastic manager of a set.
There was a famous ER director, female director, that she got only one strike, I think. She
yeah.
did the awesome. She was an ER director. She did The Peacemaker with George Clooney and Nicole Kidman. Pretty good movie.
Whoa, that's
pretty good movie.
That's a decent action movie.
The movie right after that, Deep Impact.
Which I think got an unfair shake.
Because of Armageddon.
Michael
Bay is like, get that shit out of here.
But that was another movie. That was like the first movie where they were like, black president. God.
And that was the only thing that was memorable.
This is a stunt casting.
And I think the problem with Deep Impact, not enough action. Michael Bay knew to like douse the movie throughout little action set pieces.
You know what would be the greatest?
Versus just one set piece in the last.
That would be the greatest film festival ever.
What?
You do Armageddon, Deep Impact, back to back. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Then you do
White House Down.
White House Down.
I know exactly where you're going with this.
And Olympus Has Fallen.
Yeah.
Back to back.
Yeah.
What's another
of the two?
Oh, the Magic. You do the Prestige and the Edward Norton movie.
The Illusionist.
The Illusionist.
Yeah.
Together.
Back to back. I'm sure there's plenty.
It's a great pair.
But no one's going to want to watch White House Down. That's the problem.
I like White House Down better than Columbus is, than whatever
Olympus
Has Fallen. I think White House Down is the more watchable movie.
Because it's so corny.
But yet, Olympus Has Fallen got the sequel, which was hot garbage too, and I saw it.
London
Has
Fallen. Yeah, I saw that too.
That was garbage. It's
I have it.
They're ridiculous terrorists.
Hmm?
The terrorism is... I want good terrorists.
I want good... Where are the Hans Grubers?
I want some great terrorists. I don't want these fucking copy-paste stereotype terrorists. That bores me. What the fuck happened to the guy from Lost? I thought that guy was gonna go on to play all the greatest terrorists of the 21st century, and he just won't take their parts, I don't think.
Terrorists, the problem with that is that they're too easy. It's almost too
easy to caricature them?
It's like, what do they want? I want to blow up, I want to take down the Western government, I want to, like, and then there's no meat to them. There's never any meat to them. That's why I like the Peacemaker. That terrorist... Like, he had a little backstory.
Mm-hmm.
He had a brother that he cared about, and then he took his little brother to the mission.
Yeah.
And little brother gets killed, and he's like, ah! He's like, fuck, that's really cool.
Willem Dafoe. Cruise control. Speed 2, cruise control.
Is he considered a terrorist?
You took a boat? You have hostages?
He's a one-man terrorist.
Committing
what an awful terrorist. I guess Speed had that thing where it's just a one bad guy thing. They don't have henchmen.
Yeah, it's one bad guy who, like, controls the situation.
Yeah.
And he had, like, the leech thing on his body. He at least had, like, a cool visual...
Now here's an interesting one in terms of terrorists. The True Lies terrorist. He was fun. Yet he is a victim of that caricature that we're
yeah.
talking about.
Well,
but yet somehow he was kind of fun.
My thing that bothers me about...
He was jokey.
I love True Lies as a movie. But I feel like the third act of True Lies, I want Tia Carrera to be the big, crazy supervillain.
Nah.
At the end, it makes more sense thematically for her as a woman who was, like, almost about to break up their marriage, for her to be the big, crazy supervillain at the end. Because just killing that terrorist because there's a million stereotypy terrorists and he starts falling into that category... I feel like it's not as satisfying. I feel like after you blow up the fucking Keys Bridge, that even hanging off a plane with Eliza Dushku, it doesn't top it. It doesn't top it. To me, Jamie Lee Curtis hanging off shit is a lot more impactful than Eliza Dushku hanging off shit.
Yes, because I feel that movie was... It was definitely billed as an Arnold Schwarzenegger movie, but it was totally Jamie Lee Curtis's. Like,
yeah,
role.
Yeah.
Like,
that's
she
why
had,
she should have been a part of the
was,
third act.
She was totally the most interesting character.
Yes, totally.
And she had all the shit going down.
Totally,
like,
and she should have been a part of the third act.
Yeah.
She deserved that.
Yeah.
To be a part of the big last action set.
I was so happy when she won an MTV award.
Oh, she won that year?
Yeah. And she deserved it. Like, she
did.
Completely carried that movie.
She did.
She made it interesting.
What I don't get is, like, I feel like the MTV awards have...
Completely
like,
fallen out.
Like, when I was a young man and MTV
yeah.
gave Chewbacca the Lifetime Achievement Award.
Or Jackie
said,
Chan.
I said, these people understand.
Yeah.
Good shit.
Yeah.
And now you give Chris Pratt a Generation Award? He's had, like, 10 movies, okay?
Yeah.
Come on. Don't put a crown on his head.
He's also Christian. Before he started, deep Christian.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah,
yeah, so, like, I think that's kind of
cool.
His
speech was, like nine things or advice, and, like, six out of the nine were, like, yo, Jesus.
Like, good for him, man. Because, you know, Hollywood is, you know, I assume it's mostly...
Jewish?
Atheists. And
atheists and Jews?
Well, I think atheist, because I'm an atheist, and I always, you know...
You assume the best of people?
I assume that with other, like, filmmakers. Like, people in the arts, in general, I feel like... A good majority of them are probably atheists, because I think I don't know. We could get into a weird topic.
You have to have. You think you need to have a sense of like
I'm
questioning.
A bit of questioning and a bit. I have to do it myself.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm gonna get here myself. I need to work hard.
Mm-hmm.
It's not Jesus take the wheel. You know, like.
Yeah. Well, also it's hard to put all your faith in a book written several thousand years ago.
Yeah.
When, you know, you can put down several thousands of words also on a paper now.
Yeah, it's like, I do this
that
shit.
Could
yeah,
mean anything,
that's true.
You know what I mean?
Like, the Bible's like, I know where this is I know where this came from. This guy. I know where this creativity
this
came from.
This guy was drunk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know where that came from. Yeah. When you're writing shit, when you're writing bullshit, you know, you get the sense of other people's bullshit.
You know, you do a great film festival, too?
What?
All movies where... Like, all action movies where people say biblical shit. So, like, you have, like, Pulp Fiction. You have, like, Boondock Saints.
Yeah, but the problem is those are such long movies to get to one biblical line.
Yeah, that's true. That's
it's
true.
Like, it's, like, all this worth it for this. Like, yeah.
For this thread? God
maybe,
damn.
Like, a scene or a montage or some shit. I don't know.
No. Sit through Boondock Saints 1 and 2.
I have a huge love for just really bad movies.
Yeah.
So that's sort of the...
Did you ever see Boondock Saints 2?
I tried.
I wanted to like it so
I
bad.
I tried.
Because it has Clifton Collins...
Julie Benz.
...in it, and he's awesome.
Yeah.
He's
great in everything. He's an underrated
actor. And basically, that whole Boondock Saints 2 movie is hot garbage. But the ending and the premise they leave you on with Boondock Saints 3, it makes you want to see a Boondock Saints 3.
Did you ever see the documentary on that director?
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, that was amazing.
Ouch.
That's amazing. But isn't that basically, now it plays differently. Because now you realize it's Weinstein versus Troy Duffy.
Yeah, and,
like
you,
it's,
and you're going
it's
for...
It's two assholes!
And you know who you're going for.
It's two
when
assholes.
It's two assholes. When it's two assholes... Well, you always knew Harvey Weinstein was an asshole.
No, obviously. But I'm saying, like, this is like a toxified asshole versus another toxified asshole.
So you go with Joe... I think his name is Joe Duffy, right?
Troy.
Troy Duffy. Like, you go, because he's the underdog asshole. You always go for the underdog asshole.
Yeah, he wants Final Cut.
Yeah.
He got Final Cut. He didn't have his final cut.
I love that scene when he's, like, telling students off, and he's like, you fucking get this shit. He's like, I know you don't see what I'm talking about. You can't see. Like, you know, he's, like, telling the student, and his kid's like, Jesus Christ. Yeah, that guy, I hope he learned his lesson, which I think he did.
Did you know how Boondock Saints 2 ends?
I turned it off.
So basically, Boondock Saints 2 ends... And
I have it somewhere here.
All of the saints go to jail. Okay?
Yeah.
And so it ends with the concept of now all of these prisoners know that the Boondock Saints are killing criminals. And now the Boondock Saints are exactly where they want to be, which is locked up with lots and lots of criminals to kill. Oh, shit.
I mean...
Come on, give me a bloodbath in prison! Starting fucking Sean Patrick Flannery... And Daryl from The Walking Dead.
That was never really that interesting a premise.
No.
To begin with.
Well, not in...
Of like, I'm gonna kill criminals.
Not in
2016. Whoa, we got a badass over here.
Not in 2016, but in 1999 when we found that shit in Blockbuster, that shit was blowing our minds. Like, whoa, someone read the Bible too hard.
These
they're gonna fucking shoot people.
They're like the Blues Brothers, but they kill everyone.
Look, they're hanging out with Ron Jeremy.
Yeah.
This is amazing.
No, the first one doesn't really hold up. The whole music video, no sound effects when you're doing a shootout.
No, it just feels so...
That's rule number two.
But it feels so of its time period. Like, that's the one thing I'll say about it.
Yeah.
Like, a lot
you
of...
You mean the post-Tarantino bullshit?
No, but
yeah.
a lot of movies that come out, especially nowadays, they find they don't have, like, you know, they don't have a time period. Like, they don't feel like they have... A grounding aesthetic. At least he was like
Unfriended 2, the dark web.
That shit
Unfriended 2.
That shit looks dope. It looks like they finally figured it out.
There's one scene.
It looks like they finally figured it out.
There's one thing that completely holds me back from liking that movie. That, yeah. Just the trailer. Is that one where the guy signs in and he goes, I'm like, no one does that when they sign in.
Unfriended One did not work. But I think it didn't work because they tried to make it all supernatural. I think by making it more reality-based, like they appear to be trying to do, I think it could be really scary. What I think is going to fuck them over is that it's coming out at the exact same time as, like, John Cho's Sundance, also all-in-one screen movie, Searching. That's about him finding his daughter and uncovering the mystery behind his daughter's disappearance.
Wasn't there one, about a girl that disappears all on the internet?
Catfish. The first Catfish before the TV show?
No,
a movie.
Not that one. It was, like,
and
the horror one.
That was the first, like, you know, internet...
There was actually a bunch.
Yeah.
Like Sarah's Missing or something. There was
a
couple.
Yeah, it was
a
nice little. It was like the new like found footage.
The new
badge.
Yeah.
Was like everything in one screen.
Did you ever see VHS? They had that,
yeah.
Skype one. I think my place is haunted.
The third one was just unwatchable though. VHS Viral is the worst. VHS 2 is good.
VHS 2 has
really good ones.
Has
especially
the,
that fucking
the raid.
Yeah.
The raid guy. That raid.
That
guy. That
shit's the best.
That why isn't Disney giving
that
guy
the
Boba Fett movie?
I don't think Disney
knows about the raid?
No, I don't think they hired anybody.
Let me tell you something. Everyone in Hollywood knows about
the
raid.
They only hire white...
Everyone knows.
They only hired white bearded guys. They know about the guys in the raid. They put them in Force Awakens.
Yeah, I know. I'm telling you, everyone knows about the raid.
But Disney...
The minute the raid came out, every single director that was doing anything action-related was like, do that in this.
Disney...
They were like, XXX, I want all that in here. Like... They were the triple X.
Put them together. Disney has never hired, in a big way, a known Asian director.
Let me tell you something, though.
They never paid Ang Lee no money to do anything.
Let me tell you something. The director of The Raid is a British dude, or Scottish dude. He's not Asian. And he's a fat bearded guy.
Is he?
Yes.
I thought he was a little Asian guy.
Let's look for him.
I assumed he was Asian.
No.
That's my reason.
He actually, I saw his first movie. I saw his first movie about internet, where this guy pays people to beat up homeless people. It's like a horror movie.
Oh shit, I remember. Is that a Danny Trejo movie or no?
No. Okay. Right here. The director is Gareth Evans.
Oh, there you go. Oh, that's right. Yeah, Gareth Evans. Yeah, it was confusing with Gareth Edwards because of the game.
That's what it was. Footsteps. I saw his first movie. They gave it to. I got it in a horror film festival.
Whoa.
The guy just gave it to me.
Oh my god, I know that. There's another horror movie that uses that exact same tunnel. With Duncan Jones, that was actually pretty good.
Let me see where he's from. Is he British or?
Footsteps. There's your hot take. Go see Gareth Evans.
First movie.
First 2006.
It's enough. It's very slow paced. It's nothing like The Raid, so don't expect that. In his other, I have his other kung fu movie, the one he did before that. Supposedly, he was on set for Dread. Like I heard rumors.
Oh, and he helped out.
Yeah, that's how he did The Raid. Is that he just stole the idea.
From Dread,
which is
no.
If you look at Dread, it's the exact same plot, though.
But he got it out first because they didn't have effects.
Yep.
Hey, steal from.
That was a rumor. That was a rumor.
Steal from the best.
Steal from the best. Is he in Dread? Let me see. I don't see anything with him. Maybe, you know, that could just be bullshit rumor. But damn, rumored to do the Deathstroke movie.
That, as a solo. For DC? Starring Joe Manganiello? Is Joe Manganiello?
Isn't this the guy? Isn't he already?
Yeah. He's at the end of Justice League. But they're not going to give him a solo for me. I don't think that's... That's never going to happen.
Like, who's going to pay money for
that's
this?
That's never going
to
happen.
Who's going to pay money for this?
Who's going to pay money to be...
Lydia, would you pay money for this?
Yeah, I would.
Yes.
I would.
You would see that?
I would.
You would like to see that?
But, you know, the Now This Is Podcasting audience is a lot different. The normal audiences sometime. Because he should start a romantic comedy just like that, I think.
Just exactly like this?
A supervillain romantic comedy.
I'd see that.
Hmm? Where he falls in love. I saw The Rampage. He was fun in The Rampage.
He was in Rampage?
He was like... He was the agent who's like leading the team to get the wolf. The big-ass wolf.
What an awful movie.
Which was ironic because he played a wolf on TV in True Blood. So it was like, oh, this is so meta. That's not really meta.
That's probably the worst. Like that, I don't know who that guy is that made that movie with The Rock. Apparently, like, he has it where he can make movies really cheap but very special effects, and he gives all his money to The Rock, and that's why The Rock did San Andreas and then this
and
one.
Skyscraper. And Skyscraper, I'm sorry, looks fucking awesome.
No, it doesn't.
I saw they have a even more plot in the trailer, and you know what? I'm more into it, the more plot. Because the movie's apparently going to start, and his family is in the building already on fire. So he actually starts by making that crazy jump.
Where he goes in?
Yeah, that crazy jump, that's his intro. That's the way he starts his action.
With his leg?
Jumping off of a crane into the building that's already on fire.
I'm not interested. Just
that's,
what The Rock is doing.
They're starting out with the biggest moment. That's exciting.
Not interested.
I'm trying to see what Doug Jones movie this was, because I swear to God, they shot it in that same freaking tunnel from Footsteps. Absentia. That was actually a pretty good movie. The tunnel shot. Just lit it differently. But it's like a tunnel in California. That's like, that apparently people get like raped and murdered in and stuff sometimes.
Is it like the tunnel from Irreversible?
Because there's like half a mile between each end or some shit like that. Or
creepy.
Something weird.
Creepy.
So it's dangerous.
Creepy.
So the whole point of this Absentia movie that we saw many years ago, 2014, was that somebody disappears in the middle of the tunnel and then it's like basically 40 minutes of like some girl looking around being confused.
So what are the beauties and what are, like the curse, what, it's a curse and a gift. That horror is doing so well. Is it that now...
Like the X-Men 2, we are both cursed and gifted.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like the Spider-Man shit. That now it seems like horror is going to be more blended, which in theory I kind of like. But then...
But there's more of it.
In
and
practice...
And it's more in people's front of their mind.
Yeah, and in practice, you got Jurassic World, Fallen...
Kingdom.
Kingdom. Which
yeah, is really bad.
You saw it?
Oh, yeah. I saw it opening night, and it was...
I think you were trying to convince me to see
bad.
It. It's bad, right?
No, I did not convince you to see it.
You did not say it was good?
I did not say that.
If I pull it up right now...
I don't think I did. You can check it. You can check to see if Steve was lying in the past.
I think you were trying to sell me on seeing it.
If I was, it was just to hear you rip
or,
it.
Or you saying, it's not as bad as people say.
Well, it's not. Well, that was my first reaction on it. But the more I think about it, the more annoyed I am by it. Because the problem is that a lot of the visuals and a lot of the action works in Jurassic World. Okay? And it's good. And they have a couple of cool action sequences with Chris Pratt that really show off his character and stuff. But... The plot totally walks back any character development from the first movie between Chris Pratt and this chick.
It's like The Last Jedi.
And puts them in completely different places than you did, like, that don't really make sense. And then you sold the movie on Jeff Goldblum. And Jeff Goldblum's in...
If you didn't see that coming, you're a moron.
Huh?
If you didn't see that coming, you're a moron.
Then I guess I'm a moron.
You really thought Jeff Goldblum was going to be in the movie?
Yes, because at the end of the third act of the movie is people rolling up in suits. I'm like, Jeff Goldblum's going to be a guy in a suit coming in this door right now.
No.
And he's going to be doing some sort of thing.
Watch a trailer. Like, it's the same thing happened with Godzilla, Bryan Cranston. I was just like, guys, this guy is so dead. Because every trailer, every TV spot is showing one scene with him.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's about his wife dying. And that's it.
And
they don't show him running from Godzilla. They didn't show Jeff Goldblum running from any dinosaurs. They show him in that fucking court scene, and that's it. If you can't tell that he's not going to be in that movie, I don't know what to tell you.
So your logic is that... See, because my logic was that they've blown their load on every other visual in this movie before it's released. They're smart enough to hold their Jeff Goldblum running from dinosaurs good stuff for when people pay money. That was my thought process going into the movie.
No. This is first of all, when a movie's shitty, there is no save it for the. They put it all in the trailer.
Let's get it done.
Let's put it all in the trailer.
That's true. That's true.
And sometimes they even have what I call the 4-minute trailer. Remember when Terminator Salvation had that 4-minute trailer where you're just like, they put everything in that trailer.
I need to see how this works out.
Jesus Christ! And it's like, it was Jurassic World. You get that sense where it's like, okay.
So they're all the dinosaurs are gonna die?
Oh no! But then it's like no. But then that was the beginning of the trailer, and then they show My favorite scene ever, which is a raptor sneaking into a little girl's room, and I'm just like, oh, this is the end.
The thing is, they get even more cartoony than that.
Yeah?
Like, you literally have a raptor fucking pretending to be asleep, and then as he's about to eat somebody, he smiles at the camera before he eats somebody.
Huh.
Like, they went full cartoon.
They were waiting for that clever girl line, huh?
And,
clever girl!
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then the problem is, too, is that even though this movie feels like you're just turning Jurassic Park into a cartoon, you don't embrace the full cartoon of it.
Yeah.
Have this dude ride this fucking dinosaur with the fucking machine gun, whatever the fuck, okay?
This is who you need to get.
Let's go full fucking cartoon.
You know
then.
Who would make
what the fuck?
The perfect Jurassic Park movie?
Who?
Peter Jackson.
Oh, fuck yeah.
He would make the perfect
Jurassic Park
movie.
Yeah. If you want to know how he could, just look at his 20 minutes from King Kong.
Yeah.
He already made a better Jurassic Park movie.
Yeah.
Than Jurassic Park 3,
yeah.
4, and 5.
Yeah. His,
and 2.
I say this all the time. Peter Jackson is the most underrated action director. That man's sense of choreography and playfulness is unmatched. Even by Spielberg, everyone. Like, what he did with Dead Alive, known as Brain Dead in Europe. What he did with that, what he did with the Frighteners, how fun his little action sequence are of, like, this guy going through a mental institution while having flashbacks, being chased by ghosts, by a fucking psycho. Like, it's just, he has so much fun in all his action sequences that Jurassic Park needs to beg that man to make that movie.
The other thing, too, that Peter Jackson does that most directors don't really do, and is really why he's so good at making, like, these, like, you know, fantasy worlds and these worlds in movies, is most directors don't embrace, like, the texture of things in movies. Like, there's always a scene in any Peter Jackson movie where someone's, like, covered in gunk or goo or dirt or whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
Like, you always feel like someone is, like, really interacting with some crazy scenario and environment in, like, a very, you know, real fucking way.
Yeah.
Like, the fact that we've been through 5 Jurassic Park movies and nobody has fallen like fucking Biff Tannen into a giant fucking dinosaur shit.
Yeah.
I think is a waste of 5 Jurassic Park movies.
Yeah.
Like, not one fucking poacher or something can fucking ram his motorcycle into a triceratops turd.
Yeah.
That's a gold moment. That's what you're missing.
Who's worse off, Star Wars or Jurassic Park as a franchise?
Well, I love Star Wars. I'm not going to say Star Wars. Jurassic Park, Jurassic World.
Do you really care what's going to happen in the next Star Wars movie?
For the first time, more so than ever, because no one knows what's gonna happen. This is the ultimate magic trick. They could JJ could literally start this movie 10 years later or 3 minutes later, and it would still be an interesting movie.
Did you hear about the Kathleen Kennedy phone call?
I have not heard the rumor about a Kathleen Kennedy phone call yet. What's the rumor?
Okay, so apparently,
because it's all rumors.
It's all rumors. All rumors. All speculation. All, like, hearsay. It's all probably bullshit.
All
but
from
I
the
like
Angler.
Talking.
All from a guy that charges a $40 paywall so that bloggers can eat his crumbs of inside information.
Well,
he claims to have.
Apparently, Disney had a meeting with Kathleen Kennedy, and Disney also had a meeting with, they brought everyone, the heads of Marvel, everyone on board just to dress her down. Just to, like, talk, like, say you're doing embarrass her in front of everyone.
That's ridiculous.
Yeah,
that sounds totally made up.
Yeah,
do you think that happens in the real world, where people that aren't directly ahead of you will tell you that you're bad at your job? Does that happen? I don't think that happens.
Yeah, that does.
But they're not
Disney, dude. When you're fucking up Star Wars, and you could say I like Star Wars, whatever, but it's very clear what the public thinks.
One,
it's very clear.
It's not very clear what the public thinks.
It's very clear.
What's very clear is that Star Wars Celebration tickets sold out faster than they've ever sold out ever.
Yeah.
That's a clear, definitive financial decision, financial statement that Disney sees. So there's a portion of the fan base.
People love Star Wars.
That
they don't like
that
the movies.
This is clicking with more than ever.
It's not the first time Disney's done this. Now, rumored, and more substantial, is how Disney called up EA and said, "What are you guys doing with my Battlefront?" And
the loot boxes.
The loot boxes. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, do you believe that one?
No.
You don't believe that Disney called EA?
No.
No? Why?
Huh? Huh? Because
you don't think you don't think
okay.
the egocentric
no, no, no.
Hollywood.
I understand, but
when
you say Disney called EA.
Yeah.
Okay.
By
saying Disney called EA, that makes it seem as if Disney had no idea EA was gonna be making money off of loot boxes off of Star Wars.
They had an idea.
That's what I'm saying. They do know. But by saying Disney called EA, it kind of makes it seem like Disney didn't know what EA was doing
shit. You're looking at it all wrong.
Okay, no,
you're looking at it all wrong.
That's what that insinuates.
No.
Okay?
I'll correct you. Here's what it is. EA goes to Disney. We have a plan. This is our plan. Disney
says, great, make money. That sounds great.
That sounds great.
I
don't know this video game shit.
You do
Marvel, I don't know this Marvel shit. They let them do their thing. Now, when the backlash starts...
Okay.
That's when Disney gets involved. When it's like, wait a minute, we're hearing this, and that.
Obviously, because everything changed.
Yes.
So, when everything changes, it's clear to say, they heard it up top, everything changed.
Yeah.
Okay?
They heard it up top.
Like, that's clear.
They make that phone call.
No, but you have a clear... The phone call has to happen.
Yes.
But it could be... But hypothetically, too, it could be EA doing it internally. Let's take away loot boxes before Disney fucking... rips our head off.
Now Han Solo.
Could that also happen?
No, not with EA.
Not with EA.
No, because they don't do it with their other video games.
So they don't give in any other video games.
They drop it.
Okay.
Like the game before Star Wars was what my favorite game series, Mass Effect. Their new game, Mass Effect Andromeda, bombed.
They gave all the way.
Huh?
They gave away all the loot.
They didn't even release anything. They just stopped it. Mm-hmm. They're like, alright, no DLC, no nothing, no... That's it. We're not even going to work on it. They completely dropped. EA is also known for taking other smaller companies, buying companies,
mm-hmm.
and just dismantling them completely.
Okay.
So, you can't be doing that shit with Star Wars. So it's like, the minute they're fucking up, they just can't throw it away and be like, they get that call from Disney. What do you guys do? Why am I hearing this? Why is Reddit... The most downvoted post in history is an MAA, like a Ask Me Anything, from the makers of Battlefront. The most downvoted thread in Reddit history. Like, Disney knows all this shit. They hear all this shit.
I'm sure they do. And they want to keep people that have money happy.
Yeah.
To a degree. But Star Wars is different.
No, it's not.
Star Wars is different.
It's
than
not
all the other brands.
It's not
have.
Anymore. Not
I
anymore.
Think Star Wars is different.
From Disney has Marvel.
I understand Disney has Marvel, but Disney, Marvel, they haven't invested $14 billion yet. Okay.
They don't need to.
In turning a bunch of parks into Wakanda and all that shit. Okay.
Buddy, it's coming.
It's coming. I know it's coming, but. Even after 20 Marvel movies.
Animal Kingdom is going to get the biggest Wakanda. They're going to put Animal Kingdom back on the map.
No, put Wakanda on Epcot. I want to see that shit in the Epcot Pavilion.
Oh, like made-up countries?
Huh?
Yeah, they have made-up countries with
yeah.
next to France?
Yeah, Wakanda right next to France and Canada.
No,
right there.
No, that goes,
that's
that goes to
want.
Animal Kingdom.
No,
they already have
that.
The Africa aesthetic to complement whatever they build in there. They already have the African aesthetic. In fact, I'm pretty sure... there was rumors, again, these rumors, that the reason why Animal Kingdom exists is because someone noticed, hey, how come there's no African countries here in Epcot? And they were like, you get a whole park!
You get a whole land.
You get a whole park! Don't complain, you get a whole park! And what's going to be in this park? A zoo?
So, do you really think that... So, wait, so, in this story of Disney... Getting all
dressing
the head,
down Kathleen
all
Kennedy.
The heads of different factions of Disney together.
Yeah.
To dress her down.
Yes. They didn't. Okay. So the
what does it mean to be dressed down? Which is ironic that the very terminology of it sounds misogynist.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like
yeah.
the very terminology behind
yeah.
it sounds misogynist.
So here's what I think happened. They don't call this meeting for that. There's this meeting, whatever, a quarterly meeting, whatever the fuck. They have all the heads in there. And then, we're doing this with this guy, we're doing that. Oh, what do you think of that? Now, Star Wars. What the hell's going on?
Well,
we lost. How much has Han Solo lost? It lost a lot of money. It lost a lot of money. And if you don't think they talk about that.
It's not. Okay, they do. they lost money, but they didn't lose, like, okay. In a year,
I was at a meeting, just to bring up a point. I was at a meeting, I was at Universal having a meeting with, like, producers at Universal when Tom Cruise's The Mummy came out.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, even the producers I'm talking to are nowhere near those, but those people were talking about, like, we don't know what we're going to do, what the fuck's going to happen, blah, blah, blah. And I was just like, well, but... treat it like Fast and Furious. Those movies did not get good until Fast 5. So hope, you know? There's still hope, you know? You can
time's a charm.
Yeah, yeah.
You got time to work out the formula.
Yeah.
When there's an audience.
Yes.
Hypothetically.
Which there wasn't.
Hypothetically.
But the point is that these people talk about it.
I understand that.
And
but I just think that...
They don't ignore
Star
it. They're Disney.
Yeah, but I don't think that... But that makes it seem like Star Wars is as myopic as Star Wars fandom. Which I don't think Disney is as myopic as Star Wars fandom. I think that Disney sees that, yo, Kathleen is getting more... There's more hashtags about Star Wars consistently every day. Okay?
How bad it is.
PR, okay? PR. Now, obviously they want that talk to be more... positive, because they're Disney.
Yeah.
Disney wants everything to be zippity-doo-dah, rainbows, blah, blah, blah. They're going to talk about A Wrinkle in Time fucking every hour up to the hour up until A Wrinkle in Time is a failure, and then you're not going to hear crap about A Wrinkle in Time. Okay? It barely gets, you know, any type of, you know, DVD, Blu-ray release, fanfare, anything. It's just Disney is a financial company. But this year, most of their movies... seem to be overperforming to expectations. So, but two bombs out of a crop of 12 movies that overperformed in the big math,
no.
That equals out.
No.
No?
No. So you're saying, Star Wars, it's okay we didn't make that much money because we made money over here. They don't not do that. It's Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
It's very important. They sell a lot of merchandise with it.
Yeah, that one... thing has to carry itself.
That has to carry itself.
I understand. But...
there's a problem, and there's a huge problem.
Were Battlefront sales down?
It wasn't as good as the first one, so there's already a drop. And now they're seeing that drop with Han Solo. There's already a drop. So this drop is a huge deal, so they don't tarnish the brand, so that the next movie, little by little, starts going down. It's like the Transformer movies. Every other movie, after the third one, starts going down.
And what did they do before Solo came out? They got connected and they signed Weiss and Benioff off of Game of Thrones, who once they're done with Game of Thrones, which is the hottest TV series of the last decade, all right?
Also,
they're already in the bag on Star Wars, all right? They signed Favreau to do the live-action TV show that every fanboy has wanted for the last 20 years, that Lucas couldn't even do. That he said that he has 52 episodes in the bag written, and no one would do them. Okay? So, twice, they're saying, yo, we got top-level talent, we're ready to hand it, to keep shit going.
Now, I will address every single one of
those. But they made all of those moves before Solo came out.
Yeah.
Like, she's smart enough to hedge her bets. And know that, just in case this... garbage fire is gonna fucking get me in trouble since I had such a hard time during production. I'm gonna have some good hands coming up, hypothetically.
Yeah. Now, I will tell you this. On top of all the quality of the product itself, she hired Rian Johnson, whatever. Not getting a good look. Not getting a good look at all from The Last Jedi. You could like the movie on
Rian Johnson is the man. And he's getting his own trilogy. Those movies are coming out.
No, they're not.
Those movies are coming out?
No, they're not. All
right, when they come out.
Okay, I'm willing to make a bet that Kathleen Kennedy's going to get fired. Okay, so...
all right, let's take it. I'll take that
I'll
money.
Take, okay,
I'll
we'll take
it.
The bet.
Let's go.
Okay, so here's the thing. Rogue One. She hired who?
Gareth Evans off of...
Edwards.
Gareth Edwards off of Godzilla.
Off Godzilla.
Which was garbage.
Which was garbage and...
had a great 8 minutes.
And he was fired... mid or to the close to the end.
No, he was fired after production
because they saw the dailies
and his first cut didn't
make the cut.
He made a lot of great.
Who else did she hire?
Then she hired Tony Gilroy to fix that movie.
No, Tony Gilroy fixed that movie. No, he didn't.
And still got them $1 billion.
Yeah, no, that
he fixed that movie and got
that
them
movie
$1 billion.
Made money because it was Star Wars. But when the quality,
no, but you can't give them credit for.
Oh yes, I can.
You can't give them credit for just being Star Wars and making money.
If she would have given me the money, the movie, I could have made a big piece of shit. Still gonna make a bunch of money because it's Star Wars.
But that's not true, because Solo's a good movie.
No, because...
But it didn't make a bunch of money.
Because it was the aftertaste of Last Jedi and Rogue One. Now, who else did she personally hire? I'm quote-unquote personally. Who did she hire?
J.J. Abrams?
No, the director of Jurassic World.
Yeah.
Wasn't he supposed to do Star Wars?
Yeah, he was. Colin Trevorrow, yes. He was in the line.
Okay.
Which, thank God he didn't do it, because he is the worst writer.
Yeah.
Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom is... one of the worst written movies.
We just saw
seen.
A thing on Book of Henry.
Oh,
enough said.
God.
Book of Henry. Okay, so he was also fired. Another person she tapped. Okay, now
Michael Arndt was also on the first draft of Force Awakens off of Toy Story 4.
Sure.
He also got fired.
Sure. Okay, so who does she hire next for Han Solo? She hires these two guys,
Lord and Miller.
Yeah, who are geniuses. Have a history of literally taking any product
and making it amazing.
Making it amazing.
Uh-huh. But she wanted...
They were fired midway through.
They were fired midway through because they were not sticking to the writer of Empire Strikes Back script.
Who's probably garbage now. And also... No. Yes, yes. And also because they were doing what they do. So literally, she hired these people because they have this record, and then she doesn't let them do what they do. Right?
No.
Yes.
No.
Too jokey.
No.
Yeah. Too jokey. Too much input.
But if you're taking every rumor as true, too.
Yeah.
The lead actor, according to the rumors, hired his own acting coach.
Yeah.
Because he was uncomfortable with the performance his directors were trying to get out of
him.
No. But if that's true, then that's showing you, look, if the lead of your fucking movie thinks you're fucking up the movie.
Yeah.
That's kind of a bad sign, right?
I mean... All I know is that...
Like, if you lost the lead actor's faith in you, you've already failed.
Again, maybe, but the point is, these are all
rumors.
Her hirings. And they're also her...
But they're also rumors.
But they're not rumors. These people were fired.
Yeah, they were, but I'm saying...
That's a fact.
What we know about all these situations, because it's Disney, is all rumors and hearsay.
Yeah, but...
Because there's no
special
feature
facts.
About... How did we fuck this up, and how did we save it? Like,
no.
You know?
Yeah, no. But you could get the sense that things were rotten in Denmark from even before the movie was released.
But you're seeing a trend too, where Kathleen Kennedy, she goes and she picks like the hottest talent at that moment.
That is not good for Star Wars.
Wait. But she makes a move
that they're not good for Star Wars.
But she makes a move. That makes everyone at the studio, oh my god, she's so great.
Not anymore.
She's a genius.
Not anymore.
She got
too many
the hottest
firings.
Person. And
too
then
many
she
firings.
Figures out how to make that. And then when that shit falls apart, she still makes it work.
Let me tell
she
you something.
She still makes $1 billion.
Just wait, like, these Game of Thrones guys had the books. And when they didn't have the books, they came up with the last season, which was kind of a mess.
It was not perfect.
Kind of a mess.
Yeah.
And now I wouldn't be surprised that with this, they have to come up with their own Star Wars thing. It's going to be a mess. She's going to get so canned, dude.
That's unfair.
She's going to get canned.
That's unfair. Because part of the reason that Game of Thrones last season is a mess is because they have, you know, they don't know what the fuck.
Exactly.
You know, like with their own thing, it's their own thing. They don't have to worry about disrespecting George R. Martin's, you know, fan base and his work and all that stuff. Like, it's a tighter rope to walk trying to adapt the main, like, they're basically making the first original trilogy of the Game of Thrones, whatever it's gonna be. So there's a lot more pressure on there than there is if you're making
Star Wars
the ninth Star Wars spinoff that gets to be your original thing. You have more leeway.
Alright, so I'm
you get
willing,
to invest
I'm
more
to
of
bet,
yourself into it.
I'm willing to bet.
Then fucking your own.
That Kathleen Kennedy is about to get axed, because this is already bad word of mouth with Last Jedi. Han Solo underperforms.
Okay.
It's
okay.
It's going bad. It's going bad. It's going bad. And not only that, when you have that pressure on you with her, like, this doesn't make it easier. It, like, like especially with producers, like, when they feel like they get more control. It's what happened with DC, where the producers freak out, and they start doing all this random shit, and then that's why you have Suicide Squad being re-edited.
But,
that's why you have get Joss Whedon. He knows how to do.
Okay,
they know how to do. He knows how to do people
best,
working.
But the producers of DC are not comparable to Kathleen Kennedy. Kathleen Kennedy's resume, all right, is a lot more, says a lot more to a standard of quality. Okay.
Still.
Than the DC filmmakers, 100% still. Fuck yeah.
Who produced the DC movies?
Who produced the DC movies? Fucking the Rat Pack.
Okay.
Fucking.
I believe the Rat Pack has.
Jahari, whatever the
Rat
hell.
Rat Pack has quality movies.
I'm not saying they don't have quality movies. I'm just saying, Kathleen Kennedy's resume, only because, you know, a lot of that resume has Steven Spielberg movies on it.
Yeah.
It's strong as fuck.
Yeah.
Like, if there's anyone who knows about managing a large fan base, I think it's the people who manage Steven Spielberg's
The people
fan base.
She's picking are dropping out, or they got fired. Two people got fired, one person got
okay.
dismissed.
Okay. Even with all that going on, she's not going to get fired. You know why? Because Disney is a powerful company. They're publicly traded. If they did fire her right now, that would be a sign of weakness. Their stock would drop. She is in till episode 9. Until episode 9 comes out, I would say she has 6 months. Once episode 9 out on Blu-ray, she can say she can peace out if she wants. But 100%, she's in till episode 9. And I think she's in until Rian Johnson's trilogy is done.
That's never happening.
I think she's going to wait for it.
That's not happening anymore.
That is going to happen.
That's not happening anymore.
That is happening.
That's not happening anymore.
That is happening even more.
That's why he's so pissed off on Twitter.
That's
he knows his fault.
He's not pissed off on Twitter.
Oh.
He's not pissed off. He wanted to make this. He wanted this. This is his dream.
He fucked up.
You never leave a movie and talk about it 8 months after its release. Usually. Unless you make a fucking classic. And The Last Jedi is a fucking classic. Now that is podcasting on dress.
Whatever. We're making our bets.
That's how we're closing.
She's out.
No, she's in.
She's out.
She's in. If I win, we need to watch The Last Jedi.
I have it right here.
No.
4K, baby.
No. But you need to say all the things you like about it only. If I win. And if you win?
I guess the first fight was cool.
And if you win?
Space battle was cool.
If you win?
Yeah.
What do you want?
If I win.
Mm-hmm. It'll make you feel good. Like, I think Kenny's gone.
We have to do a DC commentary where only I talk, but you have to stay in the room the whole time.
Genius.
Uh-huh.
Genius.
Yeah. Or you only say I agree. Like, you know, like,
of course.
And you could move. You could like expand from that. It's like you're right. This
is. I got it. I have to be only supportive.
Supportive of whatever, and it, only if you feel supportive. If not, you have to zip it.
Ingenious. I have been Stephen. You have been undressed.
I've been undressed.
Undressed and undressed and fucking dressed down. That's what I'm gonna call this episode. The dressing down.
The dressing down of Kathleen Kennedy.
The dressing down of KK.
KK.
What if that was the mystery? Because, like, that was a... When I wrote my Juice musical in high school, that was, like, the secret thing that made Kato Kaelin's testimony, like, invalid in the
mm-hmm.
courtroom.
Yeah.
Was that his secret third initial also had a K, so his initials were KKK. What if Kathleen Kennedy has a secret other K in her name? And her initials are...
She's hiding it well with all these minorities.
Well, she married a Jew named Gary Marshall, so...
Oh.
That's one way to do it.
She's married to Gary Marshall. I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's her powerful Hollywood husband. You think they're going to fire Gary Marshall's wife? You know how awkward that is at a dinner party for Bob Iger?
Yeah. I don't think they... Yeah.
It's not going to happen.
No.
No.
Peter Jackson, Jurassic World.
Jurassic World 3.
Get it done. Owned by Universal?
No.
Put the Fast and Furious people in
no.
there.
You know what you should call it? To bring it back old school, call this movie, the next Jurassic movie, Jurassic Park 6, directed by Peter Jackson. Yeah, retroactively turn the other two.
Can we make another quick bet? How much you want to make a bet since they have the whole cloning thing and this new Jurassic shit? That Chris Pratt's character has raptor blood and that's how he's able to communicate with them.
Well, I saw the movie.
Yeah.
So, I know what they did with the cloning bullshit.
Yeah. So
no.
You don't think Chris Pratt was cloned?
No. They didn't. That would be cool!
With raptor blood.
That would be fucking cool.
With raptor blood.
If they had done that in the movie, I would have been into that. That is actually a cool twist to how they turn the genetic cloning shit in the movie.
I'm a raptor.
Huh? I'm part raptor. That shit would have been badass, and I would have been...
He starts running really fast, just him admitting it to himself, gives him the raptor powers.
No, he just goes like this, and then like his like fingernail is...
Yeah.
Like goes like...
His toenail.
Extra long
toenail.
Out. Yeah.
His toenail clicks.
And then there's like one girl... One black girl in the corner, and she's like, damn, I need nails like that. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That's all the acrylic. Oh, my God.
That's great.
Yeah.
He has raptor blood. Calling you now.
That's how you close
that's,
it.
That's how he's able to communicate.
Boom, raptor blood. More powerful than tiger blood. Nice.
You're listening to the Vundacast.
Check us out Mondays on radiate.fm. Listen to me and Danielle talking about movie reviews and Star Wars and Kylo Ren's nipples.
Oh my God.
And the Love Shack theme song. Well, it's not a theme song, it's just a Love Shack song by the New Adventures. But we're going to talk about all those things sometimes on the Vundacast. Mondays, radiate.fm. Tweet us at Vundacast or at Vundablog.
Vundacast?
Give it up for Vundacast, man. What an adorable name.
You're listening to the Vundacast.
We're on express elevator to hell. Going down.
Two. One. Mark.
So what topics do we talk about on the Vundacast?
We talk about whatever we like, but mostly we talk about pop culture. We talk about Star Wars.
Mira, who's Snow White?
She's supposed to be some kind of consultant. Apparently, she saw an alien once.
Whoopie fucking do.
Movies we've seen.
Don't lie, all we talk about is aliens.
All
we talk about is aliens. All we talk about is bringing things back to Star Wars. All we ever do is bring things back to 1997. Don't fuck around.
Yeah, I guess he's right. He's found us out.
In your face.
Stop selling us out, Steven. Stop telling the truth. I don't want to hear the truth, man.
Did you do it? Did you create Kylo Ren?
You will be disrupted to the dark side for a pair of pretty eyes.
Danielle, you are not alone.
Neither are you, listeners.
Mondays at radiate.fm with the Vundacast.
Chewing. We're home.
The Vundacast, which is on Mondays at Radiate. Hey, Danielle.
Yes.
Co-host of the Vundacast, co-workers.
Mm-hmm.
How many nipples does Kylo Ren have?
Well, only two, but they are glorious.
To find out how glorious they are, tune in Mondays, radiate.fm. Raylo, all year long, till episode 9 comes out, and beyond.
Check it out. I am the ultimate badass.
Yes, guys.
State of the badass art. You do not want to fuck with me.
Hey, Radiate listeners, tune in to us on TuneIn. The podcast is also there. You should stitch yourself to us on Stitcher because we're down. And if you want to Google Play with us, our podcast is also on Google Play. But I just use iTunes to subscribe to my own podcast.
Great! That's just fucking great, man! Now what the fuck are we supposed to do? We're some real pretty shit now, man!
You finished.
Man. Game over, man. It's game over. What the fuck are we gonna do now? What are we gonna do?
Subscribe to the Vundacast.